here, we're talking about Sassen, the first of the longsword kata. So what we're going to do is talk a little bit about Sassen and the importance of the first kata, then we'll go ahead and show it, and go over some do's and don'ts. So Sassen, the first kata. The Sassen is made up of two characters. The Sa in Sassen means the tip of the finger, but it also means to point. And this is where we get that the pointing finger name from. Now, the Sen in Sassen is a very interesting character, especially for us in Yoho. It is the same Sen as in Sensei, which is to say one who has gone before, a teacher, right? It also means initiative, right? And that is a huge theme in our school of strategy. Understanding what initiative is and how it works and how to sort of capitalize on it. So, Sassen can mean the pointing finger of the person who's gone before. It can also mean to point with initiative, right? This play on words is actually quite common in Musashi's writings. Now, this is another example of where Musashi's upbringing in Buddhism has shaped how he thinks about things. So in Zen Buddhism, there's this idea of the pointing finger, which is to say that basically no amount of speaking can elucidate the truth, right? And really all it can do is kind of maybe get people towards it, but usually it just ends up muddling things up. Whereas the truth is quite easy to just point directly at. And this direct pointing is the sort of hallmark concept in Zen Buddhism. For us, the kata itself, its structure and its form is basically about poking the other guy with initiative, to point with initiative, right? So it's pretty important. Now, in general, kata in Koryu and in Hyoho, particularly, the very first kata that you learn is often the most important, right? It is not only the foundation and the introduction, but in Hyoho's case, it encapsulates everything that is important about Hyoho. In other words, if all you could learn was Sassen, and you learned it deeply and truly and thoroughly, you would have no need for the other kata, right? Sassen is enough for you to understand what Hyoho is and to be able to apply it. So why do we have other kata? Because, people just aren't that dedicated. they're not going to spend all their time focused on one kata and really readily get to it. So we have other examples that go, okay, well, this is the truth, but here's the truth from another angle. Here's the truth from another angle. And if you circle this object that is the truth, right, and get many different angles of observation on it, sometimes it's easier to grasp it expediently, right? And that's what we're doing in our kata, right? So what we're going to do next is show you the technical work of how to perform the Sassen kata. Now we're going to be doing the training wheels version of the kata, where we stop and pause on the third step before interacting. So we'll show it once, we'll break down the individual parts, and then we'll go over common mistakes and ways to improve your Sassen. So, just like all the katas, Sassen starts at a distance apart from your partner. Right? I'm going to start in Dante Zen. He's going to start in Geidan. Back a little bit, he's going back a little bit, and we are good to go. So, I don't know how well you guys can see it. There's a line here on the floor. This is going to function as the center line, the line that drives from the starting center of mass of both of our bodies towards each other. Hopefully you can see it, and it'll help you sort of distinguish how we're moving in relation to one another, right? So again, I start from Tati Zen, and we begin that opening process. I push down to Chudan, he answers by going to Chudan. I push up into Haso, he lowers down to Gaidan. This is my, okay, it's time to work, buddy boyo. And for him, he goes into Gaidan, I'm like, okay, right, whatever, I got some time. I begin the steps, he follows. One, two, three. We pause for a second. Now I'm going to step forward and I'm going to cut. The cut that I'm going to make is Kiryokushi. It's a downward cut, but I'm throwing it over the sort of right side of my body. I want to make the cut large, so I'm going to make a little bit more of an extension with my elbows here. And I'm going to stop it more level with my belly button, basically, as opposed to my belt level, or just below the belt level as I would with a normal cut, right? So the cut will look like this. This is part of the changes that are made to it to make the kata more learning friendly. This is not to say that these changes are recent. I don't know when they were made. But it's, when I say changes, I mean it's different from how we fight for the purpose of being a better training aid, right? The swing is larger so he can learn how to see it faster. The sword ends up higher to give him something to strike. Though he doesn't impact it in this kata, many of the other katas involve striking the sword, and we'll talk about that more when we get to those kata. So we've come to our distance. He's in Gaidan, I'm in Haso. I am going to step forward with my right foot. So I've walked, and I've ended on my left foot. I make my next step, a long step with my lead foot. I cut as he steps off the line, boom, and thrusts. Now, when Shidashi is doing the thrust, you can either have the sword in front or behind, or you can set your spacing so that when I cut him, I'm not in range, and he can end it in front. There is there's virtue in doing it all three ways, and you should practice it each way. From this position, we're going to end with him in front. Oh, he is going to push me, so his front foot takes a little soft step, and then he comes up. And we come back to Chudan. At this point, we're going to take a hop back, just so we're in camera frame. And I'm going to begin Kamayoku. I roll up into Tate Zen. He drops down into Gaidan. And Chusa. And we roll. One, two, three. Easy as pie. Right? So, let's look at the individual steps. Facing the camera, you can see this line, right? For me, for Uchidachi, I've made my steps. One, two, three. My body is square in the line. I cut. Four. My chest and torso are perpendicular to Shidachi. In other words, I'm not stepping in any kind of fashion that turns my body oblique to the line of attack, but rather I stay right on line with this, right? One, two, three, and pause. Four, and cut. Now, for Shidachi's side of it, he starts on that same line. He's in Gaidan, and he steps. Now, his right foot's forward because he moved straight from the Chudan down to the Gaidan. He steps. One, two, three, and pauses. Steps off the line, and drives the sword in. So, this is where the center line is, right? This is the distance that he has stepped away, and he has come in to thrust. He is in Coquille Hami. So his hips are at not quite a 45 degree angle, a little bit steeper. So not 45, but steeper. Boom. His lead foot points towards the center of the opponent. Right? His back foot points 90 degrees from the center line. So back foot, front foot. Right? The heels are not quite in line, right? So not in line, off to the side of it. And this gives that angle of the hips in relation to the line attack. With the sword hand, it is not straight up and down, it's not horizontal. It's sort of 50-50, a little bit closer to the vertical. He's thrusting to the throat. Now, in the kata, there's always, the fights are always prolonged, right? Because in truth, right, if we're fighting and he swings at me, right, I take that brachial artery, right, it's one hit, and the fight's basically done. But, even though in Kyoko we like shorter katas, that's a lot of pomp and circumstance for half a second of fight. So, we assume failure, and we proceed with the next little bit, right? In Sassen, I swing, he thrusts, poof! That next little bit is a drive. So, he uses his front foot and takes a little half step, a little shuffle step. So watch his feet, poof! Just like that. So shuffle back, and shuffle forward. Now you see that as he thrusts, he's not engaging additional. In other words, it's not, right? It's not trying to jab me exactly. And there's a reason for this. In this position, he's quite strong, right? He can take an enormous amount of pressure and weight because he's lined his bones up in relation to his posture, in relation to the angle of force that he's applying, and in relation to the target that he's striking. Now, if he begins to move his arm out, that relation breaks down at the joints, right? Same way here, whoop, breaks down in the joints. So, to get this angle, whoop, and to really find it, what you want to do is you make your sassen motion, and then you pause the kata for a second. Your partner will take their hand and either cover the tip or lay it on top so it doesn't slide up your chest into your face, right? Safety first. And they'll just lean into it. And what you will do is very gently swing your arm inside or outside, hunting the place where you are mechanically strong, right? Now as you do this, a lot of people get so focused here that as they're moving, you'll see their weight sort of shift onto the back leg. You want to make sure that your weight stays in the middle, that their knees are bent, right? Because it is Coquille Hami. It is a low stance, your tail bone is tucked underneath you, your back is straight in that kind of classic C-shaped posture, right? If you are like so many people, and the reason you're looking on YouTube to see how to fight with a sword is that you don't have any friends, what you can do is you can find a corner in a wall or a brick wall, right, that have the sort of grout lines that are indented. You can apply your tip in, take a little half step, and lean into it, and really try and drive your body into it. It lets you study the position of your arm, if not the position of your whole body. And so you can begin to make do, right? But friends, people to train with are super important because it's not, if all you do is practice how to valiantly swing a sword by yourself alone, you will not be a good fencer. Because combat is intimate. Fighting a person is, you cannot fight a person well, efficiently, right? You can win maybe, but you don't, you can't do it with ease. If you're just in your own head, right? It's two person. I am responding to him. We are like dancers. In times he leads and I follow, in times I lead and he falls. If I just decide, oh, I'm just going to pet this guy, right? He's going to have some sort of response to that, of course, because he wants to avoid it. And so you really have to learn to work in harmony with other people, and your training partners are the easiest place to start, because, you know, in most cases, they don't have animosity to you, right? They're not trying to hurt you. They're not trying to make you struggle or break you down or belittle you. And so it's a good kind of stepping stone entry into dealing with people whose objective is to harm you. This is, of course, speaking in terms of hyoho as it would be applied to modern self-defense or modern conflicts. I don't expect you guys to get into a lot of sword fights, right? So, after, go ahead and make that back. He's poked. Sasa! Right? Cool. Right? This is bad for me. I'm off the line. From here, it's hard for me to come in because immediately he can chastise me. When he drives, I have a couple of options on what I can do. Right? If I want, I can take straight steps back, staying in shudan until we're in position and he pulls up. Right? Or I can try and clear my sword and arms out and bring it down into judan. Both of these are very acceptable methods for this kata. In other katas, you'll use one or the other specifically for a tactical reason. But in here, you can do both. I tend to roll out and bring down because I think it's a good habit. This motion so they can't advance as easily into your space is a good habit to have because you're creating motion out here, right? And sort of force stalling them so that you can get time to recover your position and center your weight and your inertia from going in that back step, and boom, locked and sort of even so you can go anywhere you want and can't just be pushed right back backwards. So that is the technical how-to on Sassen. It's very simple, it's very easy. We're going to go ahead and show it from the other side so you get another sense of it. Okay? So, find that center line, take a step back, drive out there. Ba-da-dum, shoot on, move into our kamae, and we step. One, two, three, just good distance. I swing at him, he pokes, and he pushes. One, two, three, right? So, for the sake of the video, he's going to take a big step back, and I'm going to take a big step forward, so we're in frame, and then kamae otoru, right? I begin the motion, he follows. And we roll up. One, two, three. Good. Easiest part. As a general rule, when you're doing kamae-otoku at the end, actually let's just talk about it as pressure in general. So when we start the kata, we're very chill, right? I'm not applying any kind of seme, I'm not trying to push him around with just my position and my intent. When we come to the middle, we're also very even. The moment we adopt our first kamae for the kata itself, that is when pressure starts, right? For me, right, I apply positive pressure. And I don't do it fast, right? I can do it slow, since it's the same thing. It's just a habit and partially the skill level of the student that you're working with. If their skill level is high, you can drive a lot faster or a lot slower as a means of modulating the intensity of the kata work that you're doing. Now, for all of the sort of yang, the drive force that I create here, he comes into a receptive form, right? He drops into that shunan, it's passive in appearance, it's easy, right? We go through our kata, and I cut, unleashing all that drive, and all of a sudden, bam, he turns the switch, powers on, and he forces the relationship to change. Now, he's in the drive, and I am forced to receive. He pushes, And eventually I fight back to a middle, right? In this middle, things are still tense. They're kind of evenly tense between the both of us. Not very high, not chill. Nice and chuga, right? Middle level. Kamayotoku begins, and we still have tension, right? We're like springs that are being crushed, crushed, crushed. And all that potential energy is right there about to blow, and then we still have it. But we decide that's enough. And we roll out. The moment you roll onto that back heel, the fight's over. Whew, you want to drop all of that tension, all of that aggression, all of that driving out. Otherwise, what'll happen is you'll do one kata, and you'll back up and you're like, and then you'll go to do the next kata, and you just are ramping up your own body's tension and aggression. And that's not useful because it's very dangerous for new students who don't know how to work. But for students who are of a skillful level, it makes the work easier for them. Because the more tension you get, basically you're applying the same thing to them all the time, the same tactic. Regardless of what you're doing, you're like, I'm going to win by forcing it, right? And once your shidachi understands that, they take you easily, and if it's too easy for them, they don't really learn very well. Because people, skillful people, when they fight, they're not all one thing. They're not all active. They're not all passive. It modulates. It changes. There's an ebb and flow to drive and receive. So you want to work realistically. Of course, there are people like what the Germans call Buffalo, right? They're the people who are just trying to win by virtue of their strength and drive. But they're not, it's not that hard to deal with because it's, again, even and simple. You know what to expect. You can work and take it easy. So now that that's done, next we'll look at some common errors for Sassen. Some common errors in Sassen. So, even though the Sassen kata is very simple, right? Don't get hit, poke the other guy in the face. There are lots of errors that beginners often make. And most of them have to do with how they interact on the line of attack. That doesn't show up real well. Let's go ahead and
we're gonna do a wire for the line.
That show up? That looks better. Okay, so this is the center line of attack. Here is your evil sword wielding dude bro who is coming to whack you, Uchidashi, right? So Uchidashi is going to come down here, pause, and give you a good swing. So he's going to end up bearish. Yeah! Right? The little sword do. Now, Uchidashi's down here. I'm a good guy, I'm a shield. Right? And he's going to come up, and then he's going to come off to the side. Now, ideally, right around here, after that pause, he is going to step this way. Very cutting into the space. He'll end completely off the line so that even his sword and rear arm are clear of it. But you want to be close, right? The closer, the better, within reason, in terms of being able to support your sword. What a lot of people do is they will kind of hop off the side over here and end up putting a lot of distance between them and their opponent. They void their own range by going sideways instead of in, right? It's a big problem. The other common problem that we see related to this is how they manipulate their body to avoid the cut, to move off the line. So if Uchidachi is striking at me, right, I want to come off the line. Now most people, when you move with their face, especially if they don't have training, will begin to move and articulate their head first. And so what you'll see is, and they'll make the cut, and you'll go, And instead of having this sort of like swing motion, this is very, very bad. One, it's slow as hell. And you know, if you try and do this, you're gonna get tagged. Two, it uses a lot of muscular effort, right? Every time I break skeletal posture, now my muscles have to start holding the load of my body even more and in an awkward position. It's like, how long can you hold a bowling ball here versus how long can you hold a bowling ball here? Your bones help you, right? So use them. So the right way to go about that is with your back straight. As you step, it just rotates. Boop, boop, boop. Now, I want to keep my face pointed at the dude the whole time. A lot of people will, right? And let their head kind of turn away, right? Because they're trying to lock the shoulders and the face. Right? The problem with this is it's super visible, right? When people are pissed at you, when they're trying to do the work at you, they focus on the thing that draws their attention the most. Now, we're using weapons, so obviously their focus would go to the weapon. But in a general sense, among semi-skilled people, they're not looking at the weapon. They're looking at the face, right? The center of how we identify who we are, which is why in so many cultures, striking the face is seen as a huge, huge insult. Especially depending on what you're striking with, right? In Thailand, the front leg push kick to the face is one of the most insulting movements that you can do to an opponent in a match. It's just basically like who you are, the center of you as a person is beneath what I walk on in the dirt, all the dung and garbage. So, anyway, no, let's try. We want right? To keep that still, to keep it even. This helps to diminish the contrast, diminish their ability to see how we're moving, and to accurately judge how far we've actually moved off the line. So when I step here, it doesn't look like I have come almost a foot out of the way of where that sword was. Mostly because I'm keeping that face pointed towards you. So it's a little technical thing. What else? When people are doing Sassen, oftentimes when they're starting, you'll see them have this sort of lean back and away. Again, this is a response to the fear of that strike. Rather than sort of whipping their head out and bringing it forward, it just kind of leans back and they keep that bent posture all the way on the back leg. Obviously, this is not appropriate because you don't have support, right? Also, your inertia, even though your foot's going forward, your weight is kind of lodged back here. If it's not traveling into the dude, I mean, yeah, it's 3 foot of razor blade and it's gonna mess him up. But, you know, we want to assume that the bad guy's better than us. Maybe he's in armor. Right? Maybe he's on a horse, right? And we have to work him. Maybe he's just real buff or really lucky, and our tiny little, like, I poked an inch into him, isn't enough to get the work done. So we want to really capitalize on our motion. Strike strong, strike stable, right? And with good posture, so that we can very easily adapt and move into any sort of direction that we want, apply force to any kind of direction that we want as the situation demands it. Other than that, hand position, right? A lot of people will really kind of just muck their hand position all over the place. Now, unfortunately, there isn't a, you know, this is the exact angle to hold your hand at, right? Because everybody's physiology is going to be slightly different. Right? Not just in terms of their height and their weight, but also their distance to their target. If I'm here, right, I need to be at a kind of this angle. But if I come up, I need to drop that angle back, and I have to have enough experience pushing things and having to deal with lots of weight at the end of that lever to be able to both know how to intuitively support that weight and force, but also to be able to apply force through it, right? So if Eddie comes up here, right? Little closer, right? It's not enough that I hit him and my body's supported and he could lean on me, right? It's not, it's a good step, but I have to know that, all right, go a little closer. I have to know that when I make contact with him, I can apply force into him that's going to be meaningful. In other words, I don't want to just be like, right? I want to do work that gets it done, because work is time, right? For every action I take, he's going to be working, right? Now, if my action is really good, it stalls his work, right? But if it's not, or my timing's poor, or my relationship is poor, or my distance is poor, what happens is I took my turn, and then he's going to shank me. That's going to be bad for me. So I want to make sure that my work is meaningful. And having good support position with your sassen is important for that. Now, this is not solely a function of muscular strength. In other words, when I'm doing my sassen, I am not clenched up. I am not like 100% tense. I'm using just enough tension to support the work. No more, no less, right? Because tension is a double-edged sword. You know, on one hand, it supports weight, and that's super important because I'm moving and I'm gonna be supporting a lot of weight as I thrust through the dude, especially if he's got armor or a lot of inertia coming at me. But that tension and that support retards your motion. In other words, I can't tense everything and move efficiently. For one, every time I try and tense and move, I'm creating a little bit of damage in my musculature and, you know, to a lesser extent into the soft tissue, ligaments and tendons. But I certainly can't move with speed. I can't move with finesse. And that's not to say that your fencing should solely be about how soft and fluttery you can flit around the battlefield, because that's not the case either, right? It's that, like in pretty much everything, there is a middle path, right? One where, yes, you have tension, but you're also supple, right? Because you're not trying to overdo it. You're not being fanatical in your application of strength or your application of softness, right? And the only way to efficiently study this in this position is by applying pressure to your partner, right? Get your sword, have them guard themselves, have them grip it, and push them around, right? One of the drills that we will do a lot in beginnings, I'm gonna go ahead and back up the camera. Ooh, I bet that made your motion stick, right? Is, look at your partner, I'm just gonna get your sword. Ooh, taboo. Right, is we'll take the sword, and with this position, we'll use our hips, right, and see how we can apply force. So all I'm doing is just turning my hips. I'm not applying any arm, right? Well, this lets me study how efficiently the power generated in pushing my hips is transmitted through my support. How well is it supported? Then I can start to study the opposite. I can isolate my hips and I can work with just the arm, right? I can get little pokes, I can choose placement, and I learn to drive my opponent, right? With just arm motion. This lets me study not only, right, because my tenochi is poor, right? I'm gonna feel it as sort of a shearing tension in the wrist, Or if I'm just like a monkey gripping thing, I'm gonna find it, that sheer intention I'll feel will be in my elbow. So the, you can use it as a diagnostic tool, basically. In a lot of Western clubs, and some of the Japanese clubs I've been to, there is almost a taboo on pushing your partner, about touching your partner, right? And that's very unfortunate, because that's, there's only one way you're going to get the information about how your force affects a person in reality, and that is by affecting a person in reality, right? Building up enough experience and data in moving a person around and doing work to them to actually be able to go in that split instant of you've cut and you've applied the power necessary to make sure that their tanto or whatever, their tessen or their short sword or their long sword doesn't come into your face, right? So don't be shy about, or maybe be shy. Don't feel like it's taboo, right? Because it's not. You are there to experience other people and learn how to deal with that experience. So get your hands dirty, with permission, of course, right? I think that about wraps up the really common mistakes with Sassen. You have anything? Nope. Okay, so that is the technical how-to on Sassen. If you're feeling a little lost, don't worry. In the next video, we're really going to delve deep into the application, some of the other forms of doing Sassen, the underlying strategies and concepts in it, things like the timing that's used, and all of that. So, look forward to it in a week, probably next Friday. Okay. So, also, you know, as always, if you want to understand this, you've got to pick up a sword and go train, right? Watching the videos alone is, it may be stimulating intellectually, or, you know, just get your hot and bothered into the collar and you turn your keyboard. but it won't bring the skill into you, right? Because again, knowing something is not enough. Your body has to know it. And your body only learns things through experience. So you gotta work, right?